We all have a fairly good idea what Melbourne 2011 looks like, and for that matter, what it sounds like. But what about Melbourne 2030? It's long been at the heart of future planning initiatives. In 2001, the then Labor state government announced a plan that looked at urban sprawl, brought on by population growth. 10 years on, Planning Minister Matthew Guy explains the status.
2030 doesn't exist as such anymore. We have a metropolitan planning policy which is in effect the guts of 2030 still in place. That'll remain until we replace it with our own document in around the start of 2012.
The Melbourne City Council is also looking to the future, with works taking place in Swanston Street. Planning spokesperson, Councillor Peter Clark.
In short, what we're doing is removing all of that vehicular access, turning it into a pedestrianised street with retention of the trams, improving the quality of tram stops, so trams will be, if you like, the priority mode of transport.
Meanwhile, the future of Mikey is uncertain after cost blowouts and service bungles. Shadow Minister for Planning and Sustainable Growth, Brian Tee.
I think Mikey is now proving to be successful and it's working. And the government is reviewing it, but it'd be very difficult to ditch it and start over. Paper ticketing system we've got is way past its use-by date and needs to be replaced.
And Matthew Guy has hinted it may be here to stay.
I understand there are obviously issues with the speed of the touch-on, touch-off, particularly in and around peak hour, and I know that's issues that the Transport Minister is addressing.
The state budget was accused of lacking vision despite its election slogan of build the future.
Is the government taking future planning serious enough?
No. I mean, their policy is very simplistic. That's, it's all about half a dozen inner city sites. Most of the demand for housing is in those middle suburbs, and they've got no plan for that. So Victorian families who want to buy a house in the suburbs will miss out.
Planning Minister Matthew Guy says
the key issue that we're focused on is housing affordability. So we have acted on land release. We've brought forward what's called precinct structure plans, two of them, and we've got a target for 50,000 residential lots this year, because what we want to do is make sure that people who have the desire to buy a property have the ability to do so.
The environment continues to take its place in discussions about development. Jill Quirk, the president of the Victorian branch of Sustainable Population Australia, says the densification of a city like Melbourne will contribute to rising temperatures thanks to something known as heat island effect.
You know, you have climate change, so you get an increase in temperature, but there is an additional increase in temperature with cities, because of the decreased vegetation, increased hard surfaces, concrete bricks that store heat. So the more dense your city is and the more you get rid of natural areas, it increases the heat in the city.
The Australian Bureau of Statistics put Melbourne's population at 4,077,000 in June last year. By 2030, that's expected to grow to at least 5 million.
I just don't think it's sustainable, even at the level we have. It's not necessary to be a megalopolis. That's what one has to look at. Who benefits and who pays with any of these things?
So what will the state of Melbourne be? Only 18 years and 212 days to find out.